Yep, it sure does. I should probably go into this one a bit more. Though as I descend into the subject matter, not only is this video unsafe for those who haven't seen the entire unfinished anime and fear spoilers, it's not safe for work either, and the aversion is understandable. Although the character designs with their large heads and uncurvy bodies are a far cry from being realistic, there's still an undeniable idealization to them in their cuteness. Just that phrase gets the reason for aversion across instantly. Idealized, lowly body type. The mere mention of Lolita Complex would understandably get some cringing, and I don't blame anyone for it. But when it comes down to how necessary this nudity may be for the narrative, Made in Abyss uses these elements as appropriately as I've ever seen them utilized. The first point to note is that the series is often in the perspective of Reg, the amnesiac robot having an outsider perspective on the society of Orth and those within, while also having the depth of emotions one might expect from a child on the cusp of pubescence. He consistently expresses an awkwardness about the human body not matched by Riko, who excuses her lack of boundaries or discretion through his nature as a robot, failing to see him as a boy while he certainly sees her as a girl. Their views and actions form a contrast indicative of their disruptive personalities, while simultaneously unifying them in their innocence and inexperience. These responses are wholly organic, and match the rest of their established characterization, even serving as the grounds for it. For instance, after the corpse weaver attack, he strips her down so that he might clean her clothes of vomit and check for injuries. And upon her awakening, we are given a large panel in which her body is shown fully, a moment immediately followed by Reg's aversion. And though Riko makes no attempt to cover herself in the rest of the scene, no panel is as overt in its view of her body, even as she boldly stands with her arms wide open, other panels placing her arms in front of her chest or cutting it out of frame. All of this subtle matching of Reg's avoidant gaze is done to further our position in Reg's shoes, or metallic feet, as it stands. But for my second point, this moment of Reg's adorable sheepishness achieves something else entirely when it comes to tonal pacing, and that is levity. For as grim as Made in Abyss is, it's not being done out of a perceived edge or the desire of the author to bash your head in with the brutality of the setting and some of those inhabiting it. The Abyss is ruthless and indifferent without question, all beings competing for their own survival. But there are only so many ways the tension can be lightened with these characters in this world. Comedy is the easiest, but with the characters being children, they aren't exactly witty enough to be throwing quips out at their discretion. Riko's excitement and eccentricities create good material to be bounced off by the simpler straight man Reg, but they aren't a comedy duo. By the time they're in the Abyss, the two are more familiar with each other, so Riko's goofy moments are less likely to register. Thus, the humor must come from the ways they play off of scenario and circumstance. Not every circumstance can be played off so easily. Nor should it, as to make light of the Abyss is foolishness. When the characters are at their absolute lowest, there is no room for any levity, and small victories like escape, or the timely arrival of a cute bunny can only distract so much from the pressing situation of Riko's poisoning and crippled arm. It does allow for some breathing room between Nanachi's exposition and Reg's ingredient retrieval for Riko's treatment, and upon his arrival, after his mind has wandered with possibility as Riko's fate hangs in the balance, he returns desperate for more information, only to get far more than he bargained for, walking into Riko being stripped, much to his horror. The moment comes as an inverse gut punch, the full exhale after the slow breathing of the previous scenes. Reg could have arrived sooner, with Nanachi excusing Reg so that she could free Riko of her sullied clothes, or later with Riko already covered up and resting, but neither would allow the viewer to breathe quite as easily. The unexpected shift in tone not only makes the whiplash somehow more amusing, but the humor is a signal that the situation has stabilized, that Reg's trust in Nanachi isn't misplaced, that his efforts to get supplies weren't in vain, even before we're told as such. It undercuts the tension with a razor-sharp precision, reminding us that things can be better before we're shown the worst, the play between tones allowing the impact of both to land as hard as they need to, and the balancing act is crucial for the success of Made in Abyss. The purity and innocence of the characters split across multiple facets of characterization and explored with their journey. It's all in line with the unflinching nature in which the series approaches the basest human elements. The swelling of Riko's hand after the poisoning and the visceral breaking of her bone, the tears, vomit, piss, shit, blood, there is no aversion there, to the point where any of it can be repulsive to a potential audience, no different from the nudity. It's all on display for the audience to take in, leaving little to the imagination so that the experience of the audience is closer to that of the characters, in both struggle and victory. The idealized cuteness of the characters is placed in a harsh juxtaposition against the grim realities of the fantastic, yet horrifying, abyss. As we gaze into it, we are not allowed to blink. Big thanks to my patrons such as Valkyon, Mathwiz, and Isaac Garland. And be sure to stick around for more.